Today, Caliban's language outdazzles the white colonizers. He utters beautiful lines in the play. In fact, Caliban utters the best lines in Tempest. For any of you who've read Tempest, consider the comment on it, is I know how to curse. 3. For me, Caliban is the ultimate mascot for Indian English playwriting. So, on 16 February 2008, I opened a play at the Hamara Shakespeare Festival in Chennai. It was called Shakespeare and She. This play was part of a project with students in two architecture colleges and the IDC at IIT. The main motto of the workshop was Shakespeare the Bard lives because his plays are the thing. And life is poorer without Shakespeare, and we should meet him at a stage when we are ready for him. So the thing is, while we have been seated, hunched over laptops, blogging, Instagramming, Facebooking, etc., the premise of the workshops was Shakespeare's characters are roaming through the streets of Mumbai. For example, Shylock in Masjid Bandar, Romeo and Juliet opposite Rhea College, Henry IV getting off a rickshaw, Cleopatra at Vasai, Koli Market, and so on. The plan was to explore the city. Basically, the idea was that they go to corners of the city which they seldom visit, and also not to do that using the local train but by BST bus routes. So every single BST bus route in Mumbai was mapped. So they got onto each bus route and then could disembark and then, of course, you know, embark on this search for Shakespearean characters. Find Shakespearean characters and create your own Shakespeare fable around that character. So it was simple. The idea was no getting intimidated by the iambic pentameters or the dai, the how, or complex plot lines or character motivations. Just step out into AMSI Mumbai, board your BST bus, shoot the characters of Apna Sheikh Saab, and that is Shakespeare. So the students shot thousands and thousands of photographs, and I'll just, you know, just to sort of distract you from all these words, we'll share a few that we have. What you have to bear in mind is it is deliberately amateur. It's not professionally shot photographs. This is what the students have done. So we'll just show you some of it. If you can see them. Can you see them? That's King George. So again, the caveat, the sort of brief was not to shoot family and friends and immediate neighborhood. They had to get out of their immediate area. So she is a lady who makes vada paos on at Khopoli station, and yeah, quite fierce. This was an in-house joke. There was a professor in the college. So all these children got it. This is at the IDC at IIT. So they got into that mud pit, became like this, and imitated that professor. This is at the Vasai beach. And she was not very kind, so she threw a fish at the boy who was there. And then apparently now they're friends, so he's somewhere in the US doing very clever things, and they're in touch. He sends money and she's
Venus
in touch.
Venus coming out of the water.
Sorry?
Venus
coming out of the water. Okay, this is Merchant of Venice, yes, and he is actually a musician on the local train. Some of you might have spotted him on the Central Line. Love's Labour Lost, this is at Cami. That's Winter's Tale, so that's the chimney on tail, on the T of the tail, and then of course the moon above. This is Julius Caesar. Romeo and Juliet, Cymbeline, Hamlet, Henry VI, Part 1, Part 2, Part 3. So this they went to our famous Madanlal and did this little tamasha. Shakespeare, yeah.
Shakespeare.
So the thing is that Shakespeare is Indian because he's actually one of our Sheikh Saab. So that's what he's called in the play. He's somebody who hangs around in, you know, Bindi Bazaar and Mohammed Ali Road. So the final bit, the final act, I conclude with a small story about how theatre transpires in the city. This is again a dear friend of ours from Bandra, an actor on the hot tin roof is what it's called. Warren De Silva is a young actor from Bandra. He bagged the Best Actor Award at TESPO, which is a youth play competition, for his rendition of Ham in Samuel Beckett's Endgame. So we begin with Mr. Beckett and conclude with him. At the beginning of 2008, Warren wrote a play called A Black Mujahid, which was performed and directed as part of the Afro-American Film Festival at the American Center. A few days later, Warren received a phone call from an inspector at Chembur Police Station. The inspector had received a complaint about a black mujahid. Warren thought it was the synopsis of the play from his police file. Warren's theatre group distributes a photocopy before each performance with information about synopsis, cast, etc. The inspector seemed to possess one such copy. The inspector in his baritone inquired about the performance. So who is this Malcolm X? Warren explained, but the inspector lost interest. Warren paused dramatically and said with a vague sort of finality, Malcolm X was a freedom fighter, kind of. The inspector had already reposed, if he is a freedom fighter, then why call him Mujahid? Then the inspector explained the reason for the call. Someone had watched the performance and was offended or worse still suspected Warren of preaching terrorism. Warren reached the police station. He was greeted very warmly by the inspector and his right-hand man, both in plain clothes. The police file was opened. The complaint was read out. It was this piece of paper which had some highly objectionable content written in it. Please investigate. The said piece of paper was the synopsis of the play. The inspector queried, if you say this play is about a black freedom fighter, why use a Muslim name Mujahid? Warren explained that Maija is an Arabic term for a person who struggles. The police didn't believe the explanation. Warren requested for an internet connection. This seemed to excite the law enforcers. Yes, I have internet on my Toshiba laptop. While Warren Googled, the inspector was an eager spectator. He was amazed with Wikipedia. He read the meaning of Mujahid and explained it to the others. He thought the complaint was a total waste of everyone's time. A printout of the Wikipedia link was filed along with Warren's statement. But there was a hitch. They didn't know how to take a printout from the laptop. The inspector and the police constable endearingly said, Beta, madad karo. Warren realized that the laptop wasn't networked to the printer. So Warren unleashed a pen drive and copy-pasted the Mujahid document into a desktop computer. Everyone in the police station was most impressed. They proceeded with the statement. Chai and nashta was organized. The inspector started chit-chatting. Where did Warren study? St. Xavier's. What did Warren study? English literature. Silence. Why not Marathi? The inspector proceeded to describe his college days, the system of education in Nashik. He asked Warren about his Natak company. Warren told him, it's a bunch of friends and so on. The inspector jotted down their names and addresses and telephone numbers. Warren was probed about performance details and for a brief history of Malcolm X. Warren gave them a longish lecture. At the end of which, the inspector said, so what you're saying basically is Malcolm X is a good man. Some more tea was ordered. The conversation meandered from Toshiba laptops to why Warren should not do a play with Mujahid in the title, and how the inspector had attempted 3 papers in English literature. By now, a 4-page statement was ready. While signing it, Warren felt it would make for a very entertaining piece of theatre. The inspector and his constable friends thanked Warren. They waved goodbye. So did Warren. Was it going to be the beginning of a beautiful friendship? This is a short history of theatre in this city. Viva Theatre, Theatre Zindabad.
Sometimes of UNESCO is not their popular note. So were you influenced by these playwrights Definitely.
And in what way?
Yeah, so Beckett was sort of, as I mentioned earlier, right at the beginning, that every play that I've written, I have consciously borrowed a line or two from most of his work. And whenever I had not borrowed a line or two from those plays, has not worked. I mean, they have been like fiascos, so I owe it to him. We have a long tradition of the theatre of the absurd in the city, leaving aside this anecdote. I mean, there are groups that work. He's a difficult, I mean, that entire tradition, Stopar, Ionesco, the, you know, the Polish playwrights, Mrozek, so on and so forth. All of that has been, I mean, there are about 12, 13 of them, Václav Havel, and, you know, many of them actually. So that tradition for about 30 to 35 years has, you know, provided a huge backbone to a lot of the work that was, you know, performed and produced in the city. Essentially two things, easy to sort of perform anywhere, and also the kind of theatre that they epitomized was very minimal. So it also meant that it was what a lot of us believed in terms of poor theatre. So you don't necessarily need to perform in a big auditorium and in a big space. So again, we have an architecture friend of ours who has this theory that Mumbai suffers from something called ESP, which is empty space phobia. Whenever there is empty space, we do something with it. So theatre, unfortunately or fortunately, is about space. So a lot of these plays lend themselves to being performed in smaller, you know, little spaces, and therefore they were also extremely popular. And then post-60s and 70s, I think it was also, you know, very fashionable to perform these texts. And of course, great material, great material. Raghu, you have a question.
Sort of built around the history of theatre and the kind of people involved in it. How do you juxtapose that with the film industry as such? Do you think there's been a borrowing of materials, an exchange of materials, or is that other sort of silos?
Look at Papura Pendharkar and that entire tradition, which was, I mean, so. So that again is an entire lecture and an entire sort of chapter in itself. But the initial, at the turn of the 20th century, you basically had, I think, three trends that were dominant, where the texts that the films were using were primarily play texts. To a large extent also, when I think the films were being shot, they were actually live action shots of what was being staged in terms of the tableau. And again, to a large extent, they were you know, extensions of plays on stage. And even today, if you look at what, you know, people like Ibsen and Chekhov have taught us in terms of the sort of three structure way of how a plot evolves, that is the beginning, middle, and then, you know, beginning, complication, and then resolving. Hindi cinema mainstream continues to do that. So that tradition has always been very, very ingrained in the scriptwriters and screenplay writers that we've had. So that tradition has continued. And for the longest, I think, till very recently, even if you look at the big film houses, 70s and 80s, you know, Yash Chopra's and Raj Kapoor's, very, very word-dependent and very, very word-dependent on play texts or writers coming from that tradition. So that continued. Somewhere, I think, and later it became a slightly more disconnected sort of, you know, environment. And that is, again, as I said, a separate story altogether. But then again, you have people like Amrit Gand, I mean, many people who have sort of worked, you know, a lot on this area and subject and who would have the facts and the plays and the films much better, you know. I'm not a film historian in that sense. Yeah.
On the first play or the last play, I mean, you forecast a doomsday future for our dear city. But did you get inspired by Jakarta by any chance?
No, this play was written slightly, I think, prior to that. So
Jakarta has been sinking rapidly for the last 10,
okay,
15 years.
Right. No, this is inspired by the fact that every time my Indigo flight takes off and it circles the city and I look down, I see that we are making a fuss about such a small, tiny plot of land and there's water on all four sides. And all someone has to do is just shake the saucer a little bit and the water is going to come into the city. It's as simple as that.
That's what has happened in Jakarta already.
Right, right. I have not been to Jakarta.
Neither have I.
Yeah. Please.
Your sense of humor, has it been appreciated and properly understood? Because I feel you blur the borders between the tragic and the comic. What is comic is also tragic.
Okay.
And so how have you been understood?
They've had a fairly decent run of shows, and I mean, people perform in them, and I don't attend all the shows, but so most of them have had a fairly healthy run of shows. So, yeah.
I meant understood the way you want them to be understood.
Good Lord. So, she's done a PhD on this, so maybe she would be better placed too, yeah. Tough one to answer, tough one to answer.
After Ramu, I knew it would be, so I'm still going to try. And it's, for humor, it's difficult to manage him. And I'm glad the last question was on humor. I'm trying to combine it. I don't have remarks, because for me, Ramu's work raises more questions than anything else. I mean, I've worked 5 years on my PhD, which is, I suppose, average, but I don't know if I have any answers. I hope my viva goes well, because I really don't think I have them. So I'm going to just address some things to Ramu. Some will also be questions. I don't know whether you'll answer them sometime. So your work reflects on Mumbai, the city you claim to love and to loathe. It's a city we all think we know. But it seems to me that you're trying to show your audience that it doesn't really know the city. That the knowledge is superficial and it's incomplete. Can you hear me better now? So the knowledge is superficial and incomplete, our knowledge of the city, and we don't care enough. I think Ramu's plays tell us that, but he does it with games and humor. And that's why I think the audience can swallow that pill a little bit better. So that's an answer to your question. And also, as far as is he understood as he wishes to be understood, I think Ramu learned from no less a person than Vijay Tendulkar that he has to let the place go. So I don't think any of us are understood the way we wish to be understood, and that's ironic and paradoxical, but that's the way it is. So Ramu's doomsday vision is also apparent in much of its work, and of course in Sky Blue, that very disturbing reading that we heard in the beginning. Funny, but disturbing. So is your view restricted then, Ramu, to the view of Mumbai as a dying city, or does the city represent the world and the future? It's clear that the dark element in your work is designed to shake the reader or the viewer out of the, you know, a complacent place. In a world where many of us imagine that we're involved, just because we're informed, thanks to the media, we know what's happening, I think your work performs a very urgent function to shake us and tell us, no, it's not enough to know. You need to think more, you need to examine more, you need to do more. The plays are surreal as well, and Ramu will take a surreal instance in real life drama and turn it into a script. And again, I think this also jars you. A building talking, a building dying. All these things, they make you realize that you need to just carefully think about the way you look at the world, right? Ramu's work, your work is closely connected with language. He's used multiple languages in most of his plays. You will have smattering of Gujarati, smattering of Hindi, smattering of Urdu. Are you still having a problem with hearing me? Is there still a problem with hearing? Okay, great. So, within the English text, you always have other languages. He's also gone to the extent of mourning the loss of language in a play he's done, The Diary of a Word, which he didn't mention today because it's not connected to the city. So he's expressed his concern for language. And is it because when language is lost, story and therefore history is lost? Is it because the use of one's own language is also one element which creates a slightly more equal world? Or is he really mourning the loss of variety and richness? And then, of course, you come to the large question. Are you, Ramu, guilty of privileging one language over others? Are we all? I think those are the questions that are raised. And so we have all these things, the serious stuff, and then you have that element of surprise in the language, in the way language performs memory and history, in the way they perform protest, or history or memory. And the language that he uses is unique. It is surprising. And this element of surprise, I think, makes whatever serious things there are in his plays something that you can touch, you can digest. Otherwise, I think we would reject a lot of it. And of course, there's that other surprise element in his work. He's written about the idea of love. In Skyview, we saw it. And also in Teen Sapna Manzil, he claims he wrote it because people said he could never write a play about a love story. So what does love represent in his work? Does it represent anything significant, or is it just incidental? These are again questions that arise, and I think all the questions lead to an enjoyment. And then of course he's put, in the final leg of the presentation, we saw that he's put Shakespeare on the streets of Mumbai. And by doing this, he's undercutting a lot of traditional notions, that of love, that of Shakespeare being English, which he said. So I think in his plays, what happens with all this undercutting is that theatre and drama move to center stage, and that's what he does best with a thoughtful panache. Thank you for that.
Also by a reflection on creativity. But it was the history and growth of the theatre in Mumbai. And what I like best is that you resuscitated the past and paid homage to the multicultural backdrop of Bombay, humble people, mill workers, even the underworld. And jazz, you took us back to the homage to jazz and Bandra, for which you have great nostalgia. If you were in St. Peter's, I was in St. Joseph's. And so perhaps the way you react to literature is also, but depends much on your own experiences also. So this was something, this is a play I would love to see. And the highlight of this evening was your play reading, which was done so wonderfully. And this building speaking with short, pithy sentences worthy of Beckett. But I thought a lot about Ionesco. I thought of Les Chaises, Amede, where there's a dead body in the house growing. And I thought of Note contre Note, where Ionesco said, tout est tragique, tout est comique. Everything is tragic, but everything is also comic. Mm-hmm. And well, the rest was said, Madame Kanore, I said it all, but bringing Shakespeare alive in the streets of Bombay, that also was Mumbai, was very interesting. Now, Mumbai sinking, was Mumbai sinking? But there's one thing I realized is that Mumbai girls don't know they're sinking. That was also a very deep irony in it. And what I liked was your humor touched with irony. Go on writing plays and come here again. Thank you very much.